Namaste. Welcome to the next video of Machine Learning Techniques course. In this video, we'll continue our discussion of abstract sketch of machine learning process. In the last video, we looked at three components of the machine learning process, which is training data, model, and loss function. In this video, we'll talk about the fourth component, which is optimization procedure. We will study an important optimization procedure called gradient descent, which is a workhorse of machine learning. You can use gradient descent to perform optimization procedure in any machine learning algorithm, though it may not be always that efficient. Then we have another process called mini-batch gradient descent, which is a cousin of gradient descent, or it is obtained by making a minor modification to the gradient descent to make it more efficient on large data sets. Let's look at what gradient descent is to begin with. So remember, we use gradient descent for optimizing the loss function with respect to values of the weight vector. So imagine you are at the mountain top and you want to approach to the valley. What kind of path will you take, right? So that path is what will be computed through the optimization procedure of gradient descent. Okay, so what we will do is at every point, we'll calculate the gradient or the slope, right? And take the direction that has got the steepest slope downwards, right? And then we'll take small steps towards that direction, and again we wait, right? We do not commit fully in that direction. We wait after some time, we actually stop, and again we repeat the process. We again calculate the gradient of the loss function here, find out where is the steepest slope downward, and again continue in that direction or take few steps in that direction, right? Until we stop again, and we keep repeating this process until we reach the valley or the final destination point that we have. Okay, so let's try to understand this process in more detail. So we use derivatives to calculate the direction of steepest descent. And derivative is calculated with respect to weight vector. So specifically, we'll calculate partial derivative of the loss function with respect to each weight and use it to make a transition to the new point in the space. So this is the typical weight update that gradient descent uses. So let's say gradient descent is at point wi at its time step. So at this particular time step, we calculate the partial derivative of the loss function with respect to value of wi at time t. And what we do is we update the value of wi by subtracting a quantity which is proportional to the learning rate, right? So we subtract the partial derivative of the loss function multiplied by learning rate, and we subtract that quantity from the existing weight value to get us the new weight value. So this becomes the weight at the next time step, or at the time step t plus 1. Okay, so this is the update rule that is used by the gradient descent. Okay, so this is the step-by-step gradient descent procedure. So we randomly initialize the weight vector. We assign some random values to each of the weight, and then we repeat the following 5 steps. So when we are at a particular point, remember that figure of coming down from the mountain top to the valley, we look around and get the direction of steepest descent, right? And the next step deals with updating the weight, right? Once you find that direction, what we need to do is we need to move in that direction, right? We need to move in that direction to some next point. So here what we do is we calculate the direction of steepest descent using the partial derivative, and we take steps proportional to the value of the partial derivative, right? So we use a special constant called learning rate that we saw in the previous slide. So this learning rate is used to scale the value of the partial derivative, and it is used to compute the update, right? So we do not blindly follow the path given by the steepest descent forever, and learning rate helps us to control that tendency. We calculate the next position, but we do not update it instantly. This is very, very important. We first calculate these positions for all the weights, and at the end, all weights are updated to their new values simultaneously. This is very, very important part of the gradient descent. If you do not do this, then it's not a gradient descent algorithm. Remember that. So the partial derivative calculation is performed based on the loss incurred at each training example due to choice of the specific weights. And this is the most time consuming process or the step in the optimization process. Imagine if you have a training set containing millions of examples, this step of calculation of partial derivative can take a long time. So can we actually make this particular thing faster, right? Can we actually train model faster, or somehow, you know, make this particular step in the gradient descent faster? So that's where mini batch gradient descent comes into picture. Now the question really is, can we calculate the partial derivative on a small number of examples and use it to update the weights? Yeah, that is correct. So mini batch gradient descent exactly does that. It uses a small number of examples for calculating the weight updates. The original version we studied is called batch gradient descent, where weight update is calculated based on partial derivative calculation over the entire example set. In mini batch, instead of using the entire training set, we'll use a small number of examples at a time to come up with the weight update. So here we divide the training set into multiple batches of fixed size. At a time, one batch is used to calculate the weight update. By weight update, we mean we first calculate the partial derivative of the loss based on this batch, and then calculate weight update based on that. Once we complete the batch of the weight updates on all the batches, we say that we completed a single epoch or a full iteration of the training set. Remember, now we are doing multiple iterations within one single epoch, right? So because we are dividing a training set into smaller batches, so in order to cover the entire training set, we need to do several iterations, right? Depending on the number of batches, right? One iteration per batch. And when we complete all such batches, that's when we complete one full iteration of the training set. So that particular single full iteration on the training set is referred to as an epoch, okay? Again, naturally, a single epoch contains multiple iterations of weight updates in a mini batch gradient descent. So every iteration will have a weight update. So every iteration is performed on a small batch of example. So in a single epoch, we have multiple batches to process. So we are performing multiple iterations, and in every iteration, one batch update happens. Hence, there are multiple iterations of weight updates that happen in a single epoch. So there is a variation of a mini batch gradient descent where we use exactly one single example to carry out the weight update, right? So we calculate the partial derivative with respect to this single example, and then we carry out the weight update. And this process is called as stochastic gradient descent, or this particular version is called as stochastic gradient descent. So we have full batch gradient descent where we calculate the partial derivative and weight updates based on the entire training set. Then we have mini batch gradient descent where we use batches of some fixed size, right, for calculating the weight updates and of course the partial derivatives. And in case of stochastic gradient descent, we use batch size of one, or we use exactly one example to calculate the partial derivative and use that for weight updates. Okay, so SGD is very, very popular in machine learning for training models on very large training sets, right? So SGD and mini batch gradient descent are generally used for training machine learning models on large data sets. Let's look at the comparison, or let's compare gradient descent, which is GD, mini batch gradient descent, and SGD, right? Everything except the gradient calculation is exactly the same as batch gradient descent. So all three processes have exactly the same process except for the gradient calculation. So all of them differ in the gradient calculation step. So while calculating gradient, we iterate our examples in the given batch and use it for the batch update. Okay, and this happens with mini batch gradient descent and SGD. So SGD and mini batch gradient descent have exactly the same code, only difference being the batch sizes. SGD uses batch size of 1, whereas mini batch gradient descent will have batch size which is greater than 1, right? And if your batch size is equal to the size of the training set, then we have a gradient descent algorithm, right? Or full batch gradient descent algorithm. How do you choose the batch size? Usually we use the batch size that is in the power of 2. This particular setting we use in order to attain optimal disk read and hence optimal I/O performance. As the number of examples in the batch go up, we get a more stable estimation of the gradient. Whereas with smaller size batches, our estimate of the gradient is unstable. It changes quite a lot from iteration to iteration. This is the price that we pay for faster gradient update. And why does this work? Because you know that the training examples are independent and identically distributed. Hence, as we start processing smaller number of examples, they are also representative of other examples in the batch. And hence, when we do the weight updates on smaller number of examples, over time, we get optimal, we get very close to the optimal optimal set of weights. And if we decide to do that with gradient descent, it just takes a very long time. Right? And because of this IID assumption, it allows us to use mini batch gradient descent and SGD on for training the model on the given example set. Learning, of course, happens faster with mini batch and stochastic gradient descent, and this is because we are expected to see representative samples from the distribution, as I said, and hence the loss optimization proceeds faster than the classical gradient descent or full batch gradient descent. Now, one of the critical points here is to select the learning rate, and that is really critical because learning rate really controls how much steps or how many steps are we going to take in the direction of the gradient, right? So, larger learning rate allows us to take longer steps, right? So, larger the learning rate, larger is the update, right? So typically you may think that with larger learning rate, we'll be able to reach the valley or the optimal point faster, but that need not be the case, right? If the learning rate is too large, we may jump over the valley and go to the other side and keep doing it, and then we eventually diverge. We generally move far away from the optimal values, right? And that way, we'll never be able to reach the valley position, right? So, too large learning rate does not help. And too small learning rate also does not help, because with too small learning rate, we'll definitely reach the valley, but it will just take a long time to do that, because we are going to take many, many small steps before we reach this particular point. So we need to have a learning rate that is not too small or too big, and you may wonder, how do we do that? We have a tool called learning curve in order to choose the learning rate. So learning curves help us to diagnose issues in training. It helps us to determine if learning is progressing as intended or whether there are any hiccups in the training process which needs our attention. So in learning curves, we have iteration number on x-axis and loss on y-axis. When the model is getting trained, the loss is expected to come down with every step. If that is not happening, then there is some serious problem. So whenever the loss is coming down with every step, we know that we are proceeding in the correct direction of the valley. But if the loss is not coming down, then we have a serious problem and we need to do something to correct that problem. And one of the ways to correct the problem is we should try reducing the learning rate and again plot the learning curve, or restart the training process and then plot the learning curve and check whether the loss is coming down with every step. If the learning curve is going down very slowly, that means the loss is reducing very, very slowly, and this could be due to small steps that we are taking due to small learning rate. When such a thing is happening, we should try to increase the learning rate so that the training can proceed in a faster manner. Sometimes there are a lot of ups and downs in the learning curve, which means the loss sometimes comes down and sometimes goes up. This could happen due to large learning rate or a small batch size. And we should try adjusting these quantities, restart the training and recheck the learning curves. So we'll have practical process, or we will have separate practical demonstrations for choosing, let's say, optimal value of learning rate, and also, you know, these three different variations of gradient descent later in this course.